Well, Merry Christmas. We're so glad that you could join us here at Orchard Community Church for our Christmas Eve service, both online and in person. If I haven't had the opportunity to meet you yet, my name's Matt. I'm the pastor here, and we're so glad that you are with us tonight. Would you join me in prayer as we open our service? God, we give praise and glory to you on this special night, Christmas Eve. It was on this night some 2,000 years ago that you touched our world with a baby in a manger that would grow up to be our Lord and Savior. Fill us with joy as we worship and celebrate, but even more importantly, fill us with a deep understanding of what it means that the birth of Christ has come in our lives and in our world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand and sing together.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
Bulletin for this service on the YouVersion Bible app. If you're joining us online, please hit the button at the top of the page. That'll open up the bulletin for you. There's a place to sign in and leave a prayer request. For those of you in person, there's a little perforated section on the edge of your bulletin. We'd love for you to fill that out and let us know that you were here. And if there's something that we can be praying for you about this week, put that on the back of that card and we will do that. We will lift you up in prayer this week. If you're joining us tonight for worship and you don't have a regular church home, I want to invite you to join us on Sunday mornings. We meet at 10:30 regularly, and there's all kinds of information on the church and our events and activities in the lobby. Check those out on your way out. Later tonight, when we receive our offering, there's going to be two ways for you to give. We always like to take a special Christmas offering at Christmas to remember that the faith Jesus calls us to is never just about us. And so this offering goes out to touch our community and to touch our world. This offering, the special Christmas offering this year, is going to go half to the local homeless prevention fund, and the other half is going to go to God's Hidden Treasures, one of our mission partners with Nita Hansen in Ukraine, giving relief to those who are caught in the middle of that very difficult situation with the war going on. So if you'd like to give to the Christmas offering, that special offering, there's envelopes in the chair backs that say special or say Christmas offering. You can also just write that on your check. If you'd like to give to our regular offering, you don't need to do anything. Just put it in the basket when it comes around, and that will go to supporting all of our regular activities and events and programs and services just like this one during the year. So I just commend that to you. At this time, I want to invite the Bondi family to come forward. They are going to light our Advent candles for tonight. So thank you for doing that, and come on down.
Tonight, we light the final candle of Advent. The first candle reminds us of the hope we have in Jesus, the coming Messiah. The second candle reminds us of the peace Jesus brings. The third candle reminds us of God's love made flesh in Jesus, our Savior. The fourth candle reminds us of the joy we experience when we discover Jesus for ourselves. Tonight we light the Christ candle as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, This candle reminds us that Christ the Lord was born this night.
Hear these words from the Gospel of John about Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And that was John chapter 1, verse 1 through 4 and 14. You get it yet?
It's flooded. One last try. I don't give up.
Thank you, Bondies. Well, at 4 o'clock, all the children filled the stage and told the story of Christmas. And they had all the angels and the shepherds and the wise men and Mary and Joseph and a baby Jesus. But tonight I want to talk to you kids who are here at the 7 o'clock and welcome you and tell you that you are so loved. And we're so glad that you're here. And we want you to know that that Christmas is about God loving you and God loving me and God loving everyone. Because Jesus was the best gift that was ever given. And I know you're excited to open gifts tonight or tomorrow. But I want you to remember that Jesus was the best gift that God has ever given us. And this is a gift. When a baby is born, your family says, oh, this is the best gift we've ever had, right? And a baby is the gift, the best gift for that one family. But when Jesus was a baby, he was the best gift for the whole world, for all the families. And God sent Jesus for everyone. And so God loves us all so much. And tonight we get to put baby Jesus in the nativity scene. Finally, we've been waiting so long. Ben and Wesley, would you guys do that for us? We finally get to put baby Jesus up there. And then there's somebody still missing that's not in the scene. We have angel, shepherd, Mary, Joseph, baby Jesus. But if you look around, you'll see that the wise men have traveled all around our sanctuary this Advent season. And they're finally over here. And it's going to take them a couple more weeks to finally get to the baby Jesus. So, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Please join me in prayer. Lord, as we come to you tonight to worship and to celebrate the birth of your Son here on earth, the birth of Jesus, who you sent to live amongst us, to teach us and to humbly show us the way that we might have life, and we give you thanks. Lord, may we say with Mary that in all of life's circumstances, let it be to me just as you say. May we believe you as Mary, Joseph, and the shepherds, and follow you. For Lord, we bow before your sovereignty in all that is unknown and in all that is unpredictable. We know that you are always present, that you, Lord, are always coming. May our ears hear you, our eyes see you, and may we recognize you, Lord, at every moment in our life. Lord, we are overwhelmed with all the messiness of our lives. Help us each to become overwhelmed with the gift of Jesus, who came to save us and offer us life everlasting. May we come to be thankful for all that you have done and are doing for us. We pray, Lord, for peace from wars, for shalom in our lives and in our community. We pray for the families of all the innocent people being injured, killed, left homeless, and hungry throughout the world. We pray that as we follow you, We will be instruments of your peace, a source of hope to all, just as your Son seeks to be in our life. We confess, Lord, that we do not always seek you, that at times we cause the strife and we ask for your forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy and forgiveness when we confess to you our sins and turn our hearts to you. Lord, may we follow you and live your story out in our lives as you call us. Thank you for the gift of your Son, our Lord and Savior, the Prince of Peace, the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, Jesus. And we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And now, may we give back to God a portion of what he so generously has given to us. May the ushers come forward.
Luke 2, verses 1 through 20, the birth of Jesus. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who he was pledged to be married to him, and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. As there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Christ, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who were lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from the throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. You rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb that conquered death. and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit and the flame, now this gospel to the whole shall not kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and by his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Sing out, praise the Father.
Praise the Father, praise. Whom angels greet with anthems sing, while shepherds watch our keeping. This, this is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing.
Well, here at Orchard Community Church, during the season, as we've referred to, our series has been called Messy Christmas, because Christmas and life can be pretty messy sometimes, can't they? Over the course of this series, I've mentioned several stories about messy Christmases that people have had, like a family who gathered all together on Christmas Day, and one of the members brought along their dog, who immediately began chasing the family cat through the house, knocking over the tree and the presents and the food and grandma, and trashing everything, leaving a huge mess. Or like another family who was enjoying Christmas morning or enjoying Christmas evening, and unbeknownst to them, very late on Christmas night, one member of the family drank a little too much eggnog, and unknown to them, threw up on the presents in the tree. So they woke up in the morning to find that huge mess. Or another family that was just having a great time opening presents on Christmas morning until finally they got to one gift where a member of the family had given everybody DNA kits. And suddenly several members of the family began to melt down, and it came out that somebody's sister was their mother. But I think I have recently come across a story that might top them all. This is about a family that decided to rent a big cabin in the mountains to spend Christmas together, the whole extended family, about 25 of them in all. And they showed up early on Christmas Eve morning. They spent a wonderful day together that ended with a big meal together very late in the evening. And so after the meal, they put the kids down and did their Santa chores, and everybody got into bed late and quickly after dinner. And then in the middle of the night, it began. Slowly, one person at a time felt their tummy begin to rumble. And then soon that rumbling became a raging volcano. And by the morning by Christmas morning, it was the worst mess you could imagine, as all 25 members of the house were running at both ends with a horrendous case of food poisoning. Now, that was bad enough, but the other problem was that this cabin only had 3 bathrooms for all 25 people, and so there were a number of other messy accidents. So if your Christmas is messy, you're not alone, and you're good now by comparison, so no need to thank me for that. Well, as we've moved through the Christmas season, we've talked about how it's really easy to fall prey to this idea that we should just be able to handle a million things in stride during this time of year, that we should be able to shop and decorate and entertain and somehow pull all of these things together flawlessly, that we should be able to create the picture-perfect Christmas moment that meets all of our hopes and dreams, when in reality, the truth is that for most of us, Christmas doesn't really end up looking that way at all. Something always seems to fall short, and often a lot of things do, and Christmas ends up being pretty messy. But you know what? A messy Christmas is a lot closer to what the actual first Christmas was like than those picture-perfect ideas that we have in our mind. Because the truth is that the first Christmas was pretty messy. There was an unwed mother. There was a father thinking of leaving. The child was born in a stable of all places, and the birth announcement came to some lowly shepherds out in the field. The first Christmas was messy because life is messy. You see, Christmas isn't about a picture-perfect moment. It's about a God who loves us so much that he meets us here in the mess. In Jesus, God entered the mess of our world, and he enters the mess of our lives with the promise of something better, the promise to be our Savior. Pray with me. Loving God, we pray that you'd speak with power tonight through this ancient story, thousands of years old. May your Holy Spirit speak to our hearts, to our lives this moment about Jesus, about how he can meet us in this life, even in the messiest moments, and be our Savior. This we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, our passage tonight, which Lizzie read just a little while ago, it begins in verses 1 and 2 with Luke, the author, explaining that about the time that Jesus was to be born, a census was called to be taken by the Roman Emperor Caesar Augustus. Now, the Romans took a census about every 14 years, and they did this to get data on how many people there were to tax and how many men there were that they could conscript for military service. So they took this census, and for this reason, Mary and Joseph left Nazareth, which was where they lived, and they headed out for Bethlehem. Verses 5 tell us that that's where Joseph was from, so that's where they went for the census. We also learn here that Joseph was a descendant of the great King David, who was also from Bethlehem. And these are important details for us to know about what's going to happen. Because thousands of years ago, the prophets had said that the Messiah, a special person that God would one day send, someone who would renew the faith of the people, someone who would deliver them from their sins, someone who would initiate God's kingdom here on earth, that he would be born in the line of David in Bethlehem. Now, verse 5 tells us that Mary and Joseph were pledged to be married. And this is where the story gets messy. Because in those days, marriages were arranged. That's not the messy part. it might seem like it to us, but not to them. An agreement was made by the two families. They signed a contract, and the two were then pledged together, and they began to plan for their wedding day. So even though they were legally married, which is what happens when you're pledged, since their wedding day had not come, there was no way that Mary should have been pregnant yet. And this was considered deeply, deeply shameful in their culture. And it was for that reason that when we looked at the story of Joseph in the book of Matthew, was that this morning? Oh my gosh, that was this morning. It seemed like weeks ago. Yeah. That when we looked at that story, it said that Joseph was planning to divorce Mary when he found out that she was pregnant. Because he knew he wasn't the child's father, which is another messy part of the story. Pledged to be married, but not no wedding day, messy, father thinking of leaving, messy. But an angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and told him that this child was from God and that this was how the prophets had said it would happen, and Joseph changed his plans. Now, clearly Joseph did not want to make an 80-mile trip while his wife was pregnant, which, by the way, they would have had to do by walking or riding a donkey. I remember taking a trip to Lake Tahoe with Melinda when she was 9 months pregnant, and she couldn't even tie her shoes, you know. I mean, that was not what you wanted to do, was take a big trip when your wife is in that kind of a state. And so this is messy too, traveling in that way. Well, since he had to go, it seems as though Mary decided to go too, probably because they wanted to be together when the baby was born. But there may have been another reason that she decided to go. She didn't need to go. Women didn't need to go. Just the man needed to go and be registered for the census. But there may have been another reason that she decided to go, even though travel at 9 months, walking or riding a donkey, would have just been a horrendous thing to do. Many scholars think that Mary decided to go to escape her hometown, to escape the gossip about her having a baby before her wedding day, and the innuendo that maybe, just maybe, Joseph wasn't the father. This was all a terrible, scandalous mess in that time. Well, with verse 6, we find out that they're headed to Bethlehem, and the time came, they make it to Bethlehem, and the time came for Mary to give birth. And verse 7 tells us that when Jesus was born, they placed him in a manger. And as you know, a manger is a feeding trough for animals, and it's this detail that makes it clear that Jesus was born in a stable, because it says there was no room available for them, no guest room available for them. Now, I know the traditional translation says there was no room for them in the inn. First thing is, there weren't a lot of inns back then. That wasn't common. And the Greek word that that is used here, it's not the typical word for inn. It's a word that more often referred to the kind of guest rooms that families typically had in their homes for extended family and friends who would come to visit. So Joseph was from Bethlehem, and he probably went to the home of his extended family there and asked to stay in their guest room, but some other member of the family who was also there for the census probably already had the room. And so it was that Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God, was born in a stable and placed in a manger. And there is no way that this is what Joseph or Mary had hoped for. I'm sure Joseph wanted a better place for his baby to be born, for his family to stay. I can't imagine how Mary felt going into labor in a smelly, messy place where animals were kept. And then there's the fact in verse 7, you might even miss it, but it says that Mary's the one who wrapped the baby in cloths after she gave birth. Usually someone else would do that, and it means that there was no one else there. They were alone in a stinky stable giving birth to their firstborn child, and it was a total mess. And we might wonder, why in the world would God let Jesus be born in this way? And I think the reason is, just as we've stated, that it's because our lives can be messy too. I think God wanted to show us that he's not afraid to touch this world, this messy world, and our messy lives. Jesus isn't scared off by that. And a lot of people think that he is. And you'll hear people say, oh, God wouldn't want someone like me. I couldn't go to church. You don't know the things that I've done. Got a family member that says if I ever went to church, I'd burst into flames because of this thought that somehow my life is too messy, that God couldn't handle that. And I think this is God's way of saying, oh yeah, I can handle the mess of your world, and I can handle the mess of your lives, and I'm ready to, whenever and wherever you are ready to meet me. Now with verses 8 and 9, Luke continues and he tells how some angels appeared to the shepherds tending their flocks. In verses 10 and 11, the angels make this amazing statement. They say to them, "Don't be afraid, I bring you great news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of Savior, a town of David, a Savior has been born, and he is the Messiah, the Lord." It's really interesting that the angel calls Jesus the Lord and the and Savior. The words of the angel make it clear, for one thing, that Jesus is the Messiah, this long-awaited person that the prophets had said God would one day send. It's happening. The one who is going to renew our faith is here. It's happening. The one who's going to deliver us from sin is here. It's happening. The one who is going to initiate God's kingdom here on earth is here. It's changing. Something's happening. But there was also a huge, huge irony here. Because a lot of the language that the angel uses here, especially the title Lord and Savior, well, those were titles for Caesar Augustus, the Roman emperor. And it's like the angel is saying, I'm here to announce to you that the real Lord and the real Savior has been born, and it's not Caesar Augustus, it's Jesus Christ who's born this day. But this was messy to do this, because Caesar Augustus was kind of an egomaniac. He was not the kind of guy that took lightly to other people carrying on being called a king by somebody. It was dangerous. And then all of a sudden, the sky is filled with the angels and the heavenly hosts singing glory to God in the highest. And it's this fantastic scene. And we should think about that for a moment. It's proclaimed to shepherds. We kind of like shepherds, don't we? We kind of imagine that they're, you know, animal lovers, get to camp out in the countryside. We think kind of highly of them. Jesus called himself the good shepherd after all. But it's important for us to remember that in Jewish culture at that time, shepherds were the lowest of the low. They were out in the fields doing God knows what. They weren't with their families. They didn't go to synagogue. They messed with animals, which made them unclean. There were so many things in Jewish culture that made shepherds be considered just the lowliest low of the low. And yet, these are the people that God chooses, first of all, to proclaim the birth of his son to. It wasn't a very impressive announcement, if you think about it. And that's kind of messy. In fact, if you were going to write a made-up story to try to convince people to have faith in your God, this is not the story you would write. It's too messy. And again, we might wonder why. Why shepherds? And again, I think this is part of God's message to us about Jesus. I think God wanted to make it clear that Jesus is for everyone. Jesus didn't come just for the important people or the special people or the super spiritual people. Jesus came for everyone, for ordinary people with messy lives like you and me. And it's at this point I want us to look at the second scripture I have for tonight. It's just one verse. It's from the book of 1 Timothy. It's 1 Timothy 1:15, and it says this. It says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. And here the Apostle Paul is talking about the mess of our lives. And I want you to notice that He talks about the mess of our lives, and he doesn't do it by pointing the finger at us. He does it by pointing the finger at himself. And he says, I know that your lives are messy because my life is messy. Because to be human is to be imperfect. To be human is to sin. And he isn't saying this to downgrade us. His goal is not to berate us. He wants us to know that real people with messy lives have hope. And that hope is Jesus. Because in Jesus, God himself came into this world in response to our mess. God didn't respond with anger. God didn't respond by rejecting us. No, God responded by laying down his own life for us. Jesus came and lived the life that you and I are supposed to live, the good life, the right life that we're supposed to live and we don't. And then Jesus took that good and right life and he offered it on the cross in place of our lives, our sinful and messy lives. And when he did that, he put right the wrong of our sins and he saved us from the mess, bringing us God's grace and love and peace and hope. And we should think about what this means, this idea that God himself in the person of Jesus came and did this, because it means that God humbled himself to an amazing degree so that he would be able to enter our world to become one of us as a baby. It's about the lengths that God has gone to reach us because of his great love for us. Think about what it must have been like for the Lord God Almighty to lay aside his majesty and his power and to be born as a helpless baby. Author Philip Yancey puts it this way. He said, how did Christmas Day feel to God? Imagine that. Imagine becoming a baby again, giving up language and muscle coordination and the ability to eat solid food and to control your own bladder. Or imagine yourself becoming a sea slug. That analogy is probably closer. On that day in Bethlehem, the maker of all took the form of a helpless, dependent newborn. And he did it for us. He entered the mess for us. So with verses 15 and 16, the shepherds, they go away looking for Jesus, and they find him, just as the angel had said, lying in a manger. And in verses 17 through 19, they tell Mary, they tell Joseph. It says they tell anyone who would listen to what they had to say. They told him about Jesus' birth, and it says everybody was amazed. But then we come to the last story, the last line of the passage, verse 20, and it's so important. It says that the shepherds went home glorifying and praising God. They went home glorifying and praising God because that first Christmas, that was a powerful experience for them. They met Jesus and it was Christmas was a powerful spiritual experience for them. And at that first Christmas, there were no brilliantly decorated trees, no masterfully decorated wrapped presents. There was no fancy dinner party. There was not the picture-perfect Christmas moment where the whole family actually shows up and gets along and does what they're supposed to do and on a yada yada, all that stuff. I mean, there was none of all of that stuff that we think that we need in order to have the perfect Christmas. Nope, it was messy. And yet it was powerful. And I believe that God wants Christmas to be powerful for us too. Because if we can look past the lights and the presents and the mistletoe and maybe past the mess that our Christmas is or maybe the mess that our life is right now, if we can look past all of those things to the true meaning of this ancient story, there is something deep and powerful in it for us there. There is a God who wants to know you, who wants to grow you, who wants to heal you, who wants to break the chains of all the things that bind you, who wants to drive the darkness the fear, the anxiety, the depression from your heart. He wants to replace those things with hope. A God who wants to change you and change your life for the better. And that is the very reason that Jesus was born. In Jesus, God entered the mess of our world to become one of us so that he might reach us. And in the end, he laid down his life to do just that. Because he loves us. Because he loves you. Pastor John Ortberg tells the story of Father Damien, who was a priest who became famous for serving those with leprosy. And he writes this: Father Damien moved to Kilauea, a village on the island of Molokai in Hawaii that served as a leper colony. For 16 years, he lived in their midst. He learned to speak their language. He tended their wounds, embraced their bodies when no one else would touch them, preached to their hearts, to people who otherwise had been left alone. He constructed homes, organized schools, bands, and choirs. He built 2,000 coffins by hand so that when they died, they could be buried with dignity. Slowly, it is said that Kilauea became a place to live rather than just a place to go to die. And for that, they said Father Damien offered hope. Father Damien also wasn't careful about the way that he lived. He didn't keep his distance from these people with leprosy, a disease at the time which was incurable and contagious. He didn't separate himself. He dipped his fingers into the poi bowl along with them. He shared his pipe. He didn't shy away from bandaging open sores. He got close, and for that, they loved him. And then one day, Father Damien stood up to preach a sermon. And he said two words that shocked everyone. He began that sermon by saying, "We lepers." You see, he wasn't just helping them anymore. Now he was one of them. From that day forward, he wasn't just on their island, he was in their skin. First, he had chosen to live as they lived, and now he would die as they died. Now they were in it together. You see, on Christmas Day, God came to earth as a baby in a manger. At that point, God wasn't just helping us anymore. No, he was one of us. Now he was in our skin. Now he was here, and we were in the mess together. The first Christmas was messy, because life is messy. Christmas is not about a picture-perfect moment. It's about a God who meets us in the mess because he loves us. It's about a God who is not afraid to get his hands dirty to help us by becoming one of us, by touching our lives, by walking alongside us, and even in the end, by laying down his life for us. Amen. And Merry Christmas. It's at this time that we begin our service of lights. As we begin the candlelight portion of our service, I want you to hear again these words from the book of John. You can get that one too, Jeremy. John wrote this: "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." The light of the candles symbolizes Jesus, the light of the world, being born. And this light has entered our world this night. I'm going to light my candle from the Advent wreath, and I'll come down the side, and I want you to pass the light symbolic again of the light of the world, Jesus coming into the light. And as we do that, we're going to sing Silent Night. We'll conclude the service on the patio, so we'll, mid-song, we'll begin to move outside. Follow my lead. To walk out as we sing, to conclude our passage on the service on the patio.
Thank you.
Sad.